Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. We just finished talking with Joyce Messier here, or whatever she says. I thought it was Messier, but I didn't pronounce it that way. It was just exploring a bit. We have a few days to talk to these Lori people, so let's... I don't know if this guy is the father of, Juno. I'm hoping not. We're gonna look around. Southwest entrance to the tenements. A sturdy metal door guards the southwest entrance to the apartment building. It's locked. The south door rattles against your knuckles, but there's no response. The door rattles again, but this time you hear an elderly woman's voice calling out from inside.
Stop banging on the door. I'm not letting any more strangers inside.
Hold on, who am I speaking to?
It don't matter who I am. Now, go on, get out of here.
This is the police. Open the door.
The police? Everyone knows the police don't come round here.
The hallway echoes with her cackle. Please let me inside. It's cold out here.
No, I already told you. I won't be responsible for any more strangers getting into the building. Go check the backyard door. Maybe someone there will.
She trails off, leaving the sentence unfinished. Visual calculus says, backyard door? There must be another entrance to the east. Kim, tell her we're a real policeman. Oh, wait.
Madame, I assure you, we are real police officers.
The lieutenant repeats dutifully. There is no reply, just faint sweeping sounds inside. All right. Look at me when I'm talking to you. No. Yeah, we can't get up there from here. Alright. To the east? Is that what it said? Backyard. Well, this is the way to the east. Okay. Can I get back here from here? Yes. In fact, we've been back here. Okay, so there's Kuno and Kuno S. Dead body. Alright. Maybe this is what she means. What's that noise down there? We talked to him from here? Smoker on the balcony. You see a young man on a balcony nursing a cigarette. His eyes have been following you for a while.
Not looking for any trouble, officer.
He says in a quiet voice. Despite the cold, his shirt hangs unbuttoned on his frame. Jama says, it's the voice of someone who has something to hide, my liege. Too late, young man. Trouble's found you. No trouble for me. I just want to know what's going on here.
I don't want to be seen talking to the gendarmerie, if that's okay. I just want to finish my cigarette.
Visual calculus says, don't let him go. This could be your witness. The balcony has a great view of the whole thing. Actually, the gendarmerie really needs to talk to you.
Is it really that important?
He asks, adjusting his shirt. Half light. Oh, wow. Like a nervous cat, he keeps stealing looks at the neighboring windows.
All right, but make it quick. Once I finish this cigarette, I have to run.
Can you tell me your name? My name? My name is Martin. Martinez. Rhetoric says that's definitely not his real name. I can figure that. You're not really called Martin Martinez, are you? No, of course not. Could you please lower your voice? He scans the courtyard. It's silent, like the bottom of a well. Every sound captured and reflected back. Authority says, ask him again. Listen, I really need your name. And I really need to finish this cigarette. He replies with a subtle smile. Empathy says, but he hasn't left yet. Looks like you've got a good view of the Whirling's backyard. Can you tell me anything about the hanging? I'll even go so far as to say that the view is a little too good, my dear Gendarmer. Do you have an estimate of when the body will be taken away? Kim says, "We will remove the body as soon as possible. Now tell us, where were you last Sunday?" "Oh," he waves lazily with the cigarette. "You already asked me that, didn't you?" Logic says, "Wait, is someone else investigating the lynching?" "Did I?" "No, not you," he gestures idly. "Some more muscular type." The lieutenant takes out his little blue notebook and writes something down. "And when did you speak to this more muscular gentleman?" "Last week? I don't know. Look." He looks around the courtyard again. Rain patters on the windowsills and dead houseplants. Too late to do them any good. Conceptualization says, "It'll take more than rain to bring this place back to life." Kim says, "You didn't answer the question. What were you doing last Sunday?" "I had a friend over." "What kind of friend?" "It was my Sunday friend." Authority says, "Makes sense. Friends are nice on Sunday. You don't have to work. You can just spend time with pals, watching rugby and drinking beer." "What's your friend's real name? Did he see something?" He doesn't reply, gesturing no with his cigarette. Under the gray sky, the neighboring windows are streaked with blood. Sorry, with rain. Why did I say blood? "I really need your name." All right, we'll talk later." "No, we won't." He takes one last drag of his cigarette before stubbing it out on the balcony. "Now, if you'll excuse me, I really need to get going." "We could succeed in this. Convince him to stay. Suggestion." "Yes. This isn't the place or time for questions. Who knows who might be watching from the distance, hidden behind the curtains." "Hey, listen. I'm just trying to make things okay again. Can we meet again somewhere else?" For a moment, the man on the balcony seems almost vulnerable. Something moves in the depths of his feline eyes, compassion, and a hint of understanding. When he speaks again, his voice is soft and deliberate. "I am sorry, but I really don't have the information you're looking for." With a flick of his wrist, he sends the cigarette butt sailing over the rail. But hold on, what's that? For a split second, his hand lingers, as though gesturing towards a stone placed right next to the front door. Suggestion says, "It's a sign." "New task. Good luck with the investigation." He walks away. So I see. He's gone. The lieutenant puts away his notebook and turns to you. "We should run after him. See where he went." "No point in running. Tenements like these often have multiple exits. If he doesn't want to talk to us, then he'll know how to hide himself." "So we just give up?" "He could be a witness, him or his Sunday friend. Either way, we need to look into that muscular type who is asking about our case. He did leave us a sign. Did you see that? He wanted to draw our attention to that stone right over there." The lieutenant nods toward a small rock and a soggy patch of grass. "If we find a way inside the building, we can ask around for his apartment." "Great, let's do that." Okay, so this rock? A stone like any other, lying in a whirl of sleet and mud. Maybe there's something under it. Turn it over. There's a key beneath it, rusty from the dirt. "This must be the front door," Kim says. "Pity it doesn't have the apartment number on it. This building has many apartments, and the man can be in any of them." "How are we going to find the right one?" "We'll just have to go in and see." "Okay. You met a mysterious stranger smoking on the balcony of the apartment building north of Martinez. You know something about the murder. Find out where he lives and question him again. Ask around for his apartment number." Okay. So that's for the front door. Can I look at this from here? No. Can we open this door with it? Yes. Sneak out after he's gone back to sleep to do something about behind Lieutenant Kitsarati's back. Interesting. Eviction notices and missing pets are plastered on top of each other. This box is filled with cleaning chemicals, smells of laundry detergent. We gotta flip up glasses, the auditor. Plus one logic, minus one authority. These flip-up sunglasses were fashionable in the old, but have since lost their popularity. Their thin gold alloy wire frames are a reminder of drug-addled bohemian artists. These days, the glasses are only favored by organized crime accountants who desire to look cool. Okay. An old shoe rack. Boots, sneakers, and old slippers. Apartment number 12. A loud, rumbling snore comes from within. These shoes come in three different sizes. Huh. Is this someone's apartment? Almost like the bathroom? These shower curtains are covered in some sort of slime. What's this? Oh, we got some money. We have enough to get that. Bloop, 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 bloop. We have enough to get that map now, I believe. 50 cents at the bookstore. I'm loving the music here. I'm loving the music in general. Just like this theme. Someone has drawn a five-pointed star on the wall. Encyclopedia says that isn't just a five-pointed star. It's an inverted white pentagram cradled in a wreath of antlers. The iconography of communism, in other words. Inspect the symbol closer. The star and antlers was developed in the sixth decade of the last century and quickly adopted by Mazov and the Communards during the Revolution. Even today, half a century later, the star and antlers retains the ability to evoke hope, disappointment, and fear in equal measure. Why is the star upside down? To symbolize the toppling of the old order. Also, some social democrats were already using it. What's the deal with the antlers? The wreath of antlers represents a natural crown. It was about building a society that could exist in accord with the natural world, and at the same time above it. Why white? Because white is the color of peace. What does it evoke in me? You see noble aims, but also mountains upon mountains of corpses. They should have taken a more measured approach. Also, you're really smart. Rhetoric says, the price of idealism unrestrained by humanism. Never again. Okay. Padlocked door. This door has been closed with a padlock. A chalk-drawn number on the board says number 11. It's a solid lump of metal, but the shackle is deeply corroded. A solid pair of chain cutters would make short work of it. Well, we have that. Better whip out those cutters. You won't get very far otherwise. Knock. No reply. Well, we're not really good at this. Hopefully it'll break the chain cutters. We'll try it, though. Use the chain cutters to cut through the padlock. Failure. What are you doing? You need to get your tools out, man. Oh, yeah. We don't use it automatically. Sorry. I don't know who I'm apologizing to. Guess I can hold it in either hand. Does it make a difference? There we go. Now we have a high chance. Failure still. What are you doing? You're trying to cut the body of the lock with the chain cutters, and it's really not working. Heal yourself now. Morale critical. Wait. Am I too late? Was I supposed to click that? Despair creeps into you, getting fat on your weakness. Whatever noble intentions you once had as a police officer, it's eating them all up now. Conceptualization says you're still coming up with sentences. That's a step up from total annihilation, right? I'm done. No one even likes cops. Kim says, yes, it can be difficult to be on the receiving end of so much distrust and outright hatred, he says with a sad half-smile. Nothing you could say would make you feel any better now. Are you kidding me? End. Cop gives up the detective genre for social realism. Another police officer resigned from the RCM following a nervous breakdown. He now lives under a bridge, drinking and occasionally throwing excrement at passersby, shouting, I never loved that woman. When asked to comment, former colleagues objected to the theory that his psychological disintegration was precipitated by his wife leaving him. It's because the Furrows lost that match, said Captain Prelemy Price. Once the man's superior officer, it's because he couldn't get a big gun from acquisitions. And anyway, police work really burns you out after a while. Satellite officer Jean-Vic Mayer, the deranged former cop's partner, commented. Sergeant Mac Torson, another former colleague, did not propose any theories, merely saying, whatever happened to him when he wasn't about birds, he got screwed, that's all. Hopefully we got a... Oh, this was a little while ago. I didn't realize the game could end that way. So if you lose all your... Is that morale? You get a breakdown. You go into a breakdown. Alright, well this will be quick. I just have to do this part over again.
Madame, I assure you, we are real...
Okay. Alright, now we run back here. It's a lot quicker if you don't read stuff and don't even let voiceover change. All I have to do is talk to this guy.
Not looking for any trouble, officer. I don't want to be seen talking to the gendarmerie, if that's okay. I just want to finish my cigarette. Is it really that important? All right, but make it quick. Once I finish this cigarette, I have to run.
Okay, that's it. Convince him to stay. Fail! Okay, this is an alternate reality, I guess. Time to bring out your secret charm, tears and begging. Show him your emotional side. Throw himself before his very feet like a dog. Please don't go. I'll stop drinking. I'll take the trash out. Just please don't leave me. Trash. The young man shakes his head in confusion. Empathy says, please don't go. I'll even stop smoking inside. Listen, I really have to go. Good luck with that investigation. He walks away. Jeez, I guess I should play it over again until I succeed like before. Because, can we do the rock thing? I can't. Wow, interesting. Okay. I'll be right back, guys, until we get back to that moment. I gotta keep trying it again until we get a success. Alright, let's try this again. Okay. Thanks for the good luck. Okay. I think this is keys. Key to apartment building. So we got that. The orbs have surprises, yeah. This. I'm gonna try to fail at this, I guess. Alright. I forgot once more, too. I really am reconstructing this. I keep forgetting to actually have the chain cutters here. Should we even? I mean, it's kind of cheating, right? The shackle snaps like a twig and the lock falls to the floor with a little thud. It should be possible to enter now. After you, detective, Kim says. I don't know. I failed before. Hard to fail again, right? We had a very good chance of it. Hi. Failure, okay. Heal yourself now. Okay. I believe it's the shackle you meant to cut, detective. The lieutenant points to the corroded loop with a gloved finger. Empathy says, he's just trying to help. Don't take it. Bad. Relax. These chain cutters are broken, Kim? Perhaps we should give it another go? Okay. Let's save here because we've now we've salvaged what was going on. Success. After you, detective. I should quick save more often. Especially before these checks. Okay. Books of critical theory on the monstrosities of capital and such. Photos of revolutionaries posing with guns. Revolutionaries love to pose with their guns. A flamboyant poster of a white star. Real lithography. Looks like some kind of bust here, and... and a dresser, I guess. Bust of Krasmaloy. Krasmazov, sorry. A plaster cast bust depicts a middle-aged man with impressive sideburns. The name of the plinth on the plinth reads Krasmazov. Why does this tenant have a bust of Krasmazov in their bedroom? The white star, Kim says. The photos on the wall? I think we have broken into the apartment of a young communard. He looks around before mumbling to himself. How fitting. Was Krasmazov a mass murderer? So I'm not gonna choose that then. Not sure myself. Okay, we got a 9mm bullet and a Samarizian lounge jacket for +1 conceptualization. We can level up again. Wow. Looks like we just leveled up lately. Savoir faire. Let's get this up to something. A classic white summer jacket, loved both by the Samarizian Communist Party and the accompanying subtopical drug traffickers. It fits you well, regardless of your political ambitions. Maybe I'll wear this instead. This also has +1 conceptualization, but doesn't come with the -1 suggestion. There we go. Wait, I put it in the wrong space. This helps my esprit de... oh, it's a jacket? Wait. Oh, it's a lounge jacket, not a shirt. And what does this help with? Esprit de corps? How is my esprit de corps? 3. And the other one helps with conceptualization? 7? Conceptualization is good enough, isn't it? Because I have +1 for both. So I think I'll just keep this then. Disco jacket. Disco ass blazer, rather. Okay. I'm not sure what that accomplished. The door number 9 is locked. A postcard for Boogie Street 46. This crumpled up postcard depicts an open air market in Boogie Street. 5 years ago, a vendor smiles as dead roosters line his stalls, hung by their feet from canopy. Red blood flows onto the muddy street. Blurry shadows of people pass. You hear someone walking around inside, rearranging the furniture. The number on the panel says 10. The walking stops abruptly, but no one comes to the door. Island Empire says you can even feel tension on the other side. This time the steps come closer. Who is this? Demands a female voice, wary and tense. This is the police. Open up. Do I have to open the door? You hear the clacking of heels again as the other side walks right up to the door. Her tone is now getting a defensive edge. Do you have a warrant? I'm not obligated to open the door if you don't have a warrant. Let's go, Kim says. We don't have a reason to get inside that apartment. Logic says it's generally easier to do things if you have literally any reason. Okay. Never mind. What about this one? Oh, it's not even a door we can do anything with. What's in here? There's someone there. Okay. 25. Is this the lady we talked to through the door? Sweeping sound. Apartment number 8. Their mailbox is overflowing. We can't knock on that door. I will talk to her after we look at this. Graffiti? The graffito says, a firing squad for the rich.
Give me a moment.
Yeah, it's her. I thought she had a shotgun before, actually. That's a broom handle. An elderly woman is leaning on her broom, her knuckles white as bone. She seems to be having difficulty breathing.
The coal never does any good for my bronchitis.
She sneezes into a dirty handkerchief. Are you all right? Should I call a doctor?
I'm fine, fine. Don't you worry about me.
Oh boy, she starts coughing, red spots appearing on her cheeks. Empathy says, you're still worried. It's very worrying.
Now, what you want from me, policeman?
Logic says, she's the cleaning lady. She knows the floor plan and the residence. I'm looking for a young male in his mid-20s, dark hair, skinny build, a smoker on the balcony. Yes, yes, I know who you mean. The scrawny boy is always smoking like the devil, right? She looks at the other end of the hallway. Perception says, somewhere in the building, a child starts crying. You hear a radio tuned to a talk show and someone taking a shower. What's he in trouble for? No trouble. I just want to talk to him. Do you know where he lives? Talk. The cleaning lady starts laughing, but it turns into a violent coughing spasm. She squeezes her broom, trying to catch her breath. Rhetoric says, what was so funny about that? He lives upstairs in room number 28. Go to the balcony. It's one of those doors there. She points east. He's usually home in the evening. Thank you. Kim turns to you. We should go check out his apartment on the balcony, see if he's home. Who are you? I'm no one, just an old woman who cleans these hallways. Do you live here? If you can call it living. She spits on the floor before wiping it off with a broom. I have a little room upstairs, right next to the coal room. It's barely bigger than a closet, but I don't complain, no. She juts out her chin, eyes shining. I have my bed and my aching bones to keep me company, and that's all I need from this world. Rhetoric says she hasn't spoken to anyone for a while. Even her sentences feel rusty. Oh, this is interesting. We can mouse over this to see how we did. Cool. I have a few questions about these apartments. Ask away, policeman. Who lives in apartment number 10? No one lives there. It's been empty for months. But I talked to someone through the door. Impossible. The cleaning lady says, shaking her head. I would know if someone had moved in there. She pauses, eyeing the hallway. Maybe it's those counterculture people again, breaking into our house like it's a public space. You're a policeman. Be good and take a look, will you? Sure, I'll go see what I can find. Great. Young people. They're worse than rats, you know. Always littering the hallways with trinkets and empty beer cans. Who lives behind the padlocked door? Oh, that one is a scientist, a future scholar. Suddenly, the old lady's face is beaming. I think he studies astrology over at the community college. Education's good. I always tell them to study. Astrology? Something to do with all those stars around the door. He asked me to leave his drawings up on the wall. You mean the star and antlers? I think that's the symbol of communism. The symbol of what now? Communism. It's a political ideology. Ah, the cleaning lady says, leaning on her broom. All I know about politics is that it has brought us more harm than good. Is one of the residents on vacation? Their mailbox is overflowing. People come and go. I don't keep an eye on everyone. Logic says they probably just moved, or died, hopefully somewhere else. That's all, thanks. She mumbles some kind of response and hacks something into her handkerchief. Okay, so we can come back and ask her more about more apartments. We took this on. Investigate apartment number 10 for the cleaning lady. She said the apartment should be empty, but there's definitely someone inside. Could it be counterculture people? Investigate and report back to the cleaning lady in the apartment building's hallway. Well, it's these people. We'll do that next episode. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next one. And always, seek adventure.